Hi, my name is Sarah Meunier, and I'm a faculty member in chemical engineering here at the University of Waterloo.
Hello, my name is Mario Ioannidis, and I'm the chair of the Department of Chemical Engineering. Welcome.
So before we get into this presentation, I want to let you know what exactly we want to do today. So we have two main goals in this presentation. The first is to talk about what exactly chemical engineering is. And the second is to highlight why the University of Waterloo has the best chemical engineering program. Okay, so what exactly is chemical engineering? Chemical engineering applies the principles of math and science, especially physics, chemistry, and biology, to solve global problems. We focus on change, so starting with one material and transforming it into a more valuable product. We also conceive and design processes that focus on transferring or transporting both materials and energy. When we set out to accomplish these goals, we focus on making processes more safe, environmentally friendly, and economical. A lot of people ask, what is the difference between chemistry and chemical engineering? And that's a super valid question because there can sometimes be quite a bit of overlap between the two fields. The best way to conceptualize the difference is to consider the scale of the process. A chemist might study a particular reaction, including the reaction kinetics, while a chemical engineer would likely be more focused on creating a safe and sustainable process for continuous production of the reaction product at the industrial scale. Obviously, this is just one example, but hopefully it gives you a good idea of what we're up to. From that explanation, you might be curious what kind of products I'm talking about. Here's a really cool thing about chemical engineers. We work in all kinds of fields. If I told you that chemical engineers make chips, what kind of chips come to mind? Poker chips? Computer chips? Salt and vinegar chips? Well, the answer is actually all three. Chemical engineers can specialize in polymers or plastic, food, or even microelectronics. We're going to come back to that idea a little bit later. Chemical engineers are often known as universal engineers because we have the scientific and technical expertise to work in a wide variety of fields. You'll literally find us everywhere. We are in every industry trying to make existing processes work better. We are working on mass production of medicines and vaccines. We are decreasing the environmental impact of processes. We are developing opportunities for renewable energy. We're looking for ways to ensure the availability of clean water and nutritious food. So now I'll pass things off to Professor Ioannidis to talk about some of the great things that are happening right here in our department.
Hello. With the dawn of the 21st century, awareness grew that the way in which we utilize materials and energy is not sustainable. We now know that a number of global challenges exist. And these challenges have been addressed by the United Nations through the development of a number of sustainable development goals. And here are some. Zero hunger, for example, addressing food security, the availability of sufficient amount of food, energy security or the availability of affordable and clean energy, water quality, climate, and so on. Everybody who watches the news understands that these are very complicated global challenges, that they're intricately connected to the utilization of materials and energy. But this is precisely what chemical engineers do. It is our discipline that mostly deals with the transformation of materials and energy into valuable products, as Sarah previously mentioned. So, and in order to do that, we use raw materials. As you probably know, all stuff is made of elements. And here is a rendering of the periodic table on the right, very recently made by the European Chemical Society, in which you can see the relative abundance of different elements, the stuff from which all stuff is made of. And what that periodic table emphasizes is that the abundance of those elements is not a given. We may find them as minerals and we process them, we transform them to make a variety of products. But as we do that, we end up dispersing these elements in a variety of ways. And I'll give you an example. In order to make food, you need fertilizer. In order to make fertilizer, you need phosphorus. Phosphorus exists as a mineral, which is mined, and then through chemical transformation is turned into phosphoric acid, which is reacted by ammonia to make the fertilizer that we all use. But after using it, this element, P, is being dispersed all over the world. There is only a finite number of atoms of phosphorus on this planet. Now, notice here how some elements are used in electronics. A lot of them used in a smartphone, for example, or in LCD displays, or in batteries. So it's very clear that we need to create a circular, so to speak, economy and a use of materials that allows us to recycle these elements. Because as it is, we have enough phosphorus for 100 more years. And the situation is perhaps more dire with other elements used in other applications. For example, graphite, lithium, and cobalt, we will need much more of them by year 2050 if we are going to meet the demand of for clean energy. So what I'm trying to tell you here is that there is a very challenging nexus or complex problem between the water, the food, the climate, and so on. A problem that has at its root the way we utilize materials and energy. And this is a space in which chemical engineering has a lot of work to do. And some of that work is done right here at the Department of Chemical Engineering at Waterloo. This is one example that shows circular economy in action. Through research that has been done in our labs by one of our faculty members, industry sprung that takes old tires and recycles them. And this is now a process that exists, you know, at an industrial scale. There are plants around the globe that are using this technology to create a circular economy for rubber. So this is just one example of the impact that chemical engineering can do towards sustainable development goals.
All right, now that we're all clear on what chemical engineers can do for a living, let's move on to talking about what the University of Waterloo has to offer to chemical engineering undergraduate students. The University of Waterloo has one of the largest chemical engineering departments in Canada, but we still have small class sizes. We accomplish this by splitting our students into streams, and we'll talk about that a little bit more later. For now, though, it's important to note that for undergraduate students, this gives you the best of both worlds. We have world-renowned professors in our department, and we're able to deliver diverse learning opportunities. Two of the main focuses of our undergraduate program are collaborative learning, so working in teams, and experiential learning. And that gets students actually doing stuff rather than just reading about it. Because of the entrepreneurial support systems we have at the University of Waterloo, some of the projects that students complete even turn into startup companies. We also have plenty of opportunities for our undergraduate students to participate in research and contribute to publications. Now, I'm sure you're wondering how we accomplish all of this in a 5-year undergraduate degree program. There's two parts to our undergraduate degree, academics and co-ops. We'll go through both, but let's start with the academics. When you first start in our program, you'll focus mostly on science and math courses. These courses will set you up with the base knowledge to be successful in your upper year courses. Don't worry though, there's also some lab courses and design projects in first year, so you can get your feet wet. With that base knowledge, you'll move on to process engineering courses like reactions, bioprocesses, thermodynamics, electrochemistry, and more. Since chemical engineers deal a lot with data manipulation to control and optimize processes, there's also courses to get you set up in those areas as well. As you get into the second half of your degree, you'll have an opportunity to choose courses that interest you and even consider specializing in a particular area of chemical engineering. Our current specializations are energy and environmental systems and processes, materials and manufacturing processes, and chemical process modeling, optimization, and control. Of course, I can't talk about chemical engineering at the University of Waterloo without talking about our co-op program. Remember when I said that we have a large department but are still able to maintain small class sizes? Well, I'm going to let you in on our little trick. When our students start in September, we split them into two groups that we call streams. After passing the first semester on campus in the fall, stream 4 goes out for their first co-op term in January, while stream 8 stays on campus for the fall and winter and goes out on their first co-op term in May. From there on, those two streams alternate 4 months on campus doing courses and 4 months working at a co-op job. There are two main exceptions to this rule. First, both streams have an opportunity for an 8-month co-op term in third year, or students can choose 2 independent 4-month co-op terms if they prefer that option. The other exception is that both streams come back together in fourth year to complete their degree. This makes for an awesome opportunity to do an impactful fourth year design project. Now, I'm sure you're wondering what kind of jobs students get for co-op. Because chemical engineering is such a wide field, there are a wide variety of potential employers. Some of the popular ones are Novacol, which is a pharmaceutical company, Toyota, which is automotive, PepsiCo, which is the food industry, the University of Waterloo, which of course is research-based, and Natural Resources Canada, which is in government. Students have job titles that might sound something like research assistant, laboratory assistant, chemical engineering intern, manufacturing intern, or process engineering intern. You may be wondering where our students spend their time on campus. Our chemical engineering headquarters is in Engineering 6, or E6 as we like to call it. In this building, you'll find most of your professors in the research labs, some classrooms, study areas, and student design laboratories. The Douglas Wright Engineering Building, or DWE, has many of our undergraduate teaching labs, computer labs, as well as our Chemical Engineering Undergraduate Student Society office. We also have some more specialized resources across other engineering buildings like computer labs, a machine shop, and a prototyping center. Remember when I mentioned that that last 8 months of academics that our students have to finish off their studies? One of the big tasks that students have in those semesters is to complete their capstone design project. This project can be any design that inspires our students. It could be based on a co-op experience or something else that a student has come across in their studies or even their everyday life. Our professors have great ideas too that they often share with our students. Last year's graduating class worked on a whole range of projects from vaccine storage, zinc air batteries, wastewater treatment, solar energy, food manufacturing, refrigeration, biodegradable products, wind power, energy storage, a whole lot of different options. One recent capstone project that I personally found really interesting was by Min, Nishida, Andy, and Gavin. They created UW Tensile. They developed a wood composite material for use as a biodegradable alternative to single-use plastic cutlery. In addition to the prototype, this group even prepared a business plan. Their project was so inspiring that they won two pitch competitions, the Norman Esch Entrepreneurship Award and the Velocity Concept Award. I want to leave you with some final ideas of what chemical engineers do in their careers. Chemical engineers are consultants, they're plant designers, they're safety specialists, and they're entrepreneurs. They design products, materials, and processes. They monitor, analyze, and improve operations. They manage teams, departments, divisions, and even entire companies. You can find chemical engineers in almost every industry. In environmental protection, like pollution control, in advanced materials, like sustainable plastics, in biotechnology, like pharmaceuticals, in the automotive industry, like weather-resistant material design, in fuels and energy, like batteries, in consumer products like food and cleaning products. Before we go, I want to leave you with a couple of extra sources of information. First, there's EngChats, which is a way for potential students to get in touch with current chemical engineering students to find out what our program is really like. You can get matched with a current student ambassador by searching for University of Waterloo EngChats. If you're looking for any additional information, you can reach out to enginfo@uwaterloo.ca. With that, I'd like to thank you for your time today. And if there's anything we can help with, please don't hesitate to reach out.